hold most of two. Don't worry. Thrilled to be here, guys. For those who were here earlier, I have a deepening personal connection to this city. All three of my children were born here.
Where were the other ones born?
Alright. The other ones were born in houses. Full-on, I know. Someone's like, what? one was like, I'm not going into too much detail. I think people have probably just had lunch, so I don't want to really get into the weeds.
Who's excited for the episode that airs this week? Okay, well, you should be.
To all youths who didn't raise your hand, got my eyes on you.
We got a cool one happening this week. How many of you, were there any, I know there were a few people that actually attended Haley Fest this past week. Okay, very few of you. They got a cool sneak preview of the episode, and it was, Jared and I got to sneak in and watch it with, a few of us got to sneak in and watch it with an audience that was maybe a little larger than this crowd here. Yeah, and it was awesome. It was certainly an experience that we had not had.
I actually found myself laughing at it, legitimately, like laughing at it like a TV show as opposed to...
Well, you also have to understand, it was the first time we'd seen it too, and we'd only seen renderings of the animation, so we had not seen the animation put to life with our voices behind it and that whole thing, so... And this was stuff that we recorded over a year ago. It's taken this long to, that's how long it takes for the animation, the whole process. So it was a pretty awesome experience. And
so for those who didn't see it, we're excited for you to see it on Thursday.
Yeah.
All right.
There's certainly a family that exists with this cast and crew, and you know, it's we have been very fortunate to have situations like this where we get to kind of all reconnect every few weeks and hang out and get to share this common love for a show. Santa Claus, you're a few months early.
Security.
It would be hard to pick. We've got a pretty solid group of people here, and I think one of the reasons why we continue to not only do the show but to do these kinds of shows is because of the people that we've. That we have in our camp, and it's a pretty cool place to be. So, you run down the list of these guys: Misha, Ruth, Rob, Rich, and all of the above. Marks and Cliff. Well, yeah, there was a guy named Cliff. I don't know. I don't think he's here today. But again, it's a pretty awesome group to be a part of, and it keeps growing, which is the coolest thing on the planet. So.
We had it's no secret, I guess, that Spade directed an episode. So he was on set, and, in the cut, and he comes in, he said the lineup, and he says to me, he's like, okay, Sam. And I was like, Sam? I was like, Spade, we've stopped the trains in Europe together. And you're calling me Sam? Like, Jared is my name. Kind of got a funny laugh about it. But to kind of echo Ackle's sentiment, we've been lucky to grow so close with a big old gang of Supernatural cast and crew, extended cast and crew. So I'm just very grateful. Hopefully all that's friends too.
All right, thank you.
It's a great defense mechanism.
I think that's really hard. I think it was pretty difficult the first time I ever read about Sam Winchester's death. I was like, oh man, I like this show. Got to do what you gotta do. And then luckily I got a script for the next episode. I was like, oh, I'm back. It's gonna be
I felt like that the first 60 times I read it. And I finally got over it.
That having been said, I did take Bobby's death. It was pretty bad. It was a great episode. It was a proper send-off. And here's the reason. And this, we didn't know that there'd be a season 13 in an apocalypse world and a season 12 where we run into like a bizarro Bobby. So what the wonderful but tragic thing about when Bobby died is it was such a proper send-off. We weren't in the episode a whole lot. You know, it was a lot of him and Rufus. And so it felt like, man, I know it's supernatural, he can come back, but that was such a proper send-off for such a beloved character that it would kind of be a shame if next episode he was like, here I am, I'm better. He'd be like, oh, come on. It was such a nice tribute to such a beloved character. But I think, luckily, with Apocalypse World, we were able to bring him back properly, but not really bring him back, but bring a version of him back. So yeah, let's go to Bobby Charlie. Yeah. Now we're all sad.
I mean, Ruby. I know one, just because there are many. The one that comes to mind, and this is only something that she would really know, because I don't really get ready for bed around anybody else. But when I'm in the bathroom and I'm like, you know, brushing my teeth and getting ready for bed, I don't know why, but I tend to do everything very mechanical and loudly. So it's almost like I'm working in a bar. Like I'm spinning the toothpaste and slamming it down, and then boom, hitting the faucet thing on, hitting it off, and she's just like, what are you doing? And I'm like, I was brushing my teeth. I don't know what the problem is. And she's like, why do you have to bang everything around? And I'm like, I'm just nothing. I don't, what? And I never realized I did it until like just recently she pointed it out, and now it's all I'm aware of. It's just, like a full-on Tom Cruise in a cocktail, just like spinning things, slamming them on the ground, doing this, kicking things, door closed over there, opening this, and I realize I make so much noise when I'm getting ready for bed. There you go. There's one thing that annoys the hell out of her too.
Two main things. I'll go with when we're at home for number one, and when we're traveling for number two. So when we're at home, I leave the doors open, like to outside. If I go outside to take the garbage out, or to feed the chickens, or to let the dog out, or something.
Which, if you live in like Southern California or in Central Texas,
spiders, tarantulas,
everything. Snakes. Yeah, snakes, mosquitoes,
and also, you know, your air conditioning bill gets a lot more expensive. And then when we're traveling, I guess there are two major things. The main one is that if I go to the gym in the morning and I sweat, so I don't, like, I'm not gonna pay $30 to wash a pair of shorts. So I'll go from the gym to the shower and start showering with my clothes on to wash the sweat off. And then I'll take it off, bunch it up in the shower and squeegee it out. And then I'll kind of put the pieces in the bathroom, like one over the bath nozzle, one on the side of the bath, because I want them to drop, because I don't want them to be moldy, you know? And she gets so mad, because there'll be like a sock over here, a sock over there, a workout shirt, a beanie, and she's like, your stuff is all over the bathroom, like I can't do anything. And then if I leave for a little bit, then I get mad, because then when I go somewhere, she'll bundle it all up and throw it in with like a t-shirt that wasn't a workout shirt. And I'm like, you're throwing it with workout clothes that are nasty and stinky, and I'm gonna wash those when I get home. So I know she doesn't like that very much. And I keep the AC on super cold, like 65 degrees. That's what I'm talking about. So I get home and I'm like, it's a sauna in here. She's freezing.
Yeah, the temperature, the thermostat is a constant battle in my family, and will forever be. I'm going to point out one thing, a pet peeve of his, that is a pet peeve of mine. Something that you do that is a pet peeve of mine. Whenever he comes into my trailer. Which is often, we're often, you know, coming and run lines or, you know, chatting about whatever, you know, talking about what we're going to do this weekend. Walk up, and there's a countertop right there, and then, like, a sink on the back side of it, and then there's, like, chairs and stuff over there. He'll walk up, no joke, every time I can set my watch by it, he does this. And puts his gum on my counter. Every time. And I'll walk over and I'll see it and I'll be like, why? He's like, well, I'm not done with it. Like every single time. Like, it's almost like he's like taking his shoes off before he enters someone's house. He walks into my trailer and he takes the gum out of his mouth and puts it on my countertop, and then he does. He picks it back up and puts it in his mouth and leaves. And I'm like, we have an infinite supply of gum at craft service, an infinite supply.
Gum tastes better when it's been exposed to oxygen.
That is not true.
Smacking makes it taste better. Yes. Y'all got something to learn. We're all gonna secretly go home and go like, all right, let's give it a shot. Like, here we go, go, okay, I'll be damned.
Like Will Ferrell, Elf, you find the gum underneath the subway. Oh my gosh, these are so old, they're amazing. They've been exposed to oxygen for years.
Jenny was telling me this story. She was going through customs. She had flown from Austin to Vancouver. This was years ago. Tom was a baby. And the person in front of her, you know, you go to the counter and here's my passport, here's my declaration, and I'm coming here to visit. And she's like, we had just had our first kid. And she's looking, and the kid is maybe like 4 or 5 years old in front of her. And the kid is like holding up the counter going like this. And the poor parents don't see what's going on because they're terrified they're going to get deported or something. So they're like dealing with their passport. Finally, the kid is like trying to pick himself up. And Jen's watching this all go down, like, what is going on? What's wrong with this kid? So finally, he gets up and pulls a piece of gum. And Jen's like, oh God.
And then Jared looks at the kid and goes, hey.
Hey, is there any more down there?
Say something for me.
Put it right up.
It's gross, you need to stop it. Hi.
Don't hog it.
Gum doesn't go on the counter.
Yes, it does. It'll get better. You will try it.
You will try it. These are the droids you're
looking for. What kind of whiskey would you add to our collection?
To desk whiskey?
To our desk whiskey collection.
To your desk whiskey. Well, I will say, I'll say the one that is popular not on the set of Supernatural. Or anywhere close to production, would be Bullet Bourbon.
Yeah. Yeah, Bullet 10 is not much more expensive, but it's a lot smoother.
Thank you.
There you go.
Thank you.
Enjoy. Nope.
Is on set, what is your most embarrassing moment?
That's a great question. I ripped my pants.
Yeah, the hard thing is that you know, I don't really get embarrassed about much. Is the problem. He ripped his pants and immediately was like laughing louder than anybody else. himself. You know what? I tend to get, because of the nature of the show, a lot of it is smaller sets. It's either on a soundstage or it's in an empty building or a dilapidated house or something to that effect, where there's not a lot of additional performers on camera. So he and I have gotten really used to working with like minimal surroundings. Whenever we do big scenes with a ton of extras, or when we're addressing a crowd or doing anything with a ton of people, it gets a little bit more intimidating. And when you're addressing like a big crowd of extras, and you're trying to give them like a motivational speech, you're doing something, and then you turn around and you fall on your face. That was pretty embarrassing. The good thing is that I work with people that don't like to exploit that very much. Oh no, wait, they put it like four times in the gag reel. It's the only moment they repeat it literally four times. That was, like I said, I don't get embarrassed often, but for some reason that one was, that was teed up for embarrassment on that one.
There's also, I don't want to say it's embarrassing, but there's a certain dynamic to when you work with these guys and gals on the crew, on the cast, and script supervisors, and gaffers, and grips, and electricians, construction guys and gals, and then when you have a sex scene to shoot, and so all of a sudden these people you've known, you know their kids' names, their wives' names, you meet like in public, and you're like, okay, all right, sorry guys, about to take all my clothes off. You're embarrassed for them because they like don't want to look at you. They're like, hey, how's your family? It's good. Looking around, I'm like so awkwardly trying to avoid looking at you because you're standing there in your underwear. I'm like, it's all right, buddy. We've all got them.
Yeah, but you get the opposite, which is this. And then you have to tell Cliff to go back out to the parking lot.
On season 3 on the writer's strike, Jensen, did you feel this would be the end and that you would have been stuck in hell forever?
Yeah, technically the writer's strike ended when we came back in that
The last day of shooting before the writer's strike was the mystery spot diner scene, the sandwich just before we were in bed.
Right. We didn't really know what was going to happen. We knew obviously that the strike wouldn't last forever, but we knew it was going to be it was going to last for a while. And at that point, they almost had to bring us back because the writers weren't writing anything else. So they weren't creating anything else to replace us. Everybody was on strike. So when the strike was lifted and the studios were then like, okay, let's get back to work, then it was basically everything that was on air had a bit of a, you know, immunity clause in it. So we knew that we were gonna be safe as far as that particular season went, but we didn't know how long. In fact, as soon as we wrapped, I shaved my head, just because I don't know why, but I just did. Because I knew it was going to be at least a while before we came back, and by then my hair would have grown out. So, but yeah, that was an interesting time.
So my question is, I was going to ask, since a lot of us spend a lot of time online looking at pictures of you guys and things about the show, what's your favorite thing that you found online about you guys or the show?
I posted it. My L'Oreal commercial as the gym. Somebody, if you're in here, I'd like to give you a hug. Somebody photoshopped
me. You used the word.
No, it was like they put me on a GIF of Beyonce, like twisting around. And I was mesmerized. I never had that reaction looking at myself.
A nightmare.
I couldn't figure out if it was a nightmare or a dream. I was just like, what is happening now? I think I just forwarded it to about every single person I knew. And then it started speaking random numbers. Like, hey, you think about it? 424-837-1234. Who is this? Never mind. Cool gift, huh? That made me laugh for sure. And then the as far as the show, it was the nine styles, the nine hairstyles of the Winchester brothers. That came forward many, many times. So that's my personal and show favorite internet moments.
I don't know if this was all servers or whatever, but when Apple added that where you can send GIFs and the text message thing, and there were plenty of Dean and, or myself, and I started using those GIFs to send to my buddies back home. They were so angry. You can't give yourself. I can. That's gone a long way in my world.
I want to text thread with a few other buddies, and one of them is a mutual friend of ours, and he sent a GIF that was somebody going like this, and it just said, bless this post, because there was a funny text earlier. And I looked closer, and it was Pellegrino, I was Lucifer, doing this, and said, hey, bless this post, and Walker. And I was like, hey, Walker, thanks for the supernatural shout-out. He was like, what? You just used a supernatural GIF. He's like, damn it. He didn't realize. I love that we've infiltrated even, like, our buddies who don't want to send supernatural.
Who don't even know that there's anything supernatural. such glorious payoff.
Our wives do the lion's share of kid-friendly. Thank God, because that means our six children have a chance. I think I've struggled a lot with feeling bad about being gone, not being there, pick them up from school, drop off, to some practices, this and that. And I've had many people tell me who have older kids, you know, 10, 12, 14, whatever, say it's more about the quality than the quantity. You know, you have parents who are around their children all the time and have not a great relationship with their kids because they're not present. And so I think one of the blessings of our curse of not seeing them a lot is that we have to make the most of our time with our kids. So when we're with our, you know, speaking for myself, I know he as well, when we're with our kids, it's playtime, you know? Like you're chasing tarantulas and lizards and jumping in the pool and playing in the swing set and chasing each other around and doing hopscotch and walking around the neighborhood. So I think it's just trying to get as much quality time as possible.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Do you have a sister named Jared?
Angel? Or would it be an angel?
Two angels.
How would you do it? Because you've thought about this.
I'm not a writer then, honestly.
Well, neither are you.
I don't know, like, I've read a lot of, like, not read, but I've seen fan fictions of people writing about Buffy and Dean together.
I'm cool with that. Yeah, all right, great. Write that. Dean, Buffy.
What about Sam?
Then have Scooby run by in the background. Run by, run around. Yeah.
Yo, what's Sam doing when Dean's off the Buffy?
Walking the dog. So tell us a joke.
Okay. I'm good.
Jared, tell us a joke.
Okay. A guy walks up to the meat market. He orders a steak and kidney pie. The butcher says, "I think he just said kidney." The guy says, "No, I diddly." No, I diddly.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
I asked, and it was, I should have known.
Julie.
Yes.
I can row a boat. Canoe?
Okay.
No, don't leave, please.
All right, so my question is going to be kind of a mashup between my question and my friend Chrissy's question. Excuse me. Is there any regular TV shows or reality TV shows that you personally like watching on downtime? Like, is there any of that? Any Housewives? Jersey Shore? I don't know.
There's only one Housewives. It's New York. Come on.
Sell him out. So,
please do.
We have TV in our trailers, right? And they splice it. You know, we have a box to our trailers, a cable box to our trailers, but it's on like a whole home system. So if I record something, it shows up in his trailer. And if you're listening, just watch it. What was the episode? I had like 3 days off when we were filming. It was some episode like 3 months ago or whatever it was.
It's called Below Deck.
Yes. Below Deck.
Below Deck.
I show up and I'm like, I can record 30 episodes of Below Deck in the last 3 days. What's going on? So it's like a yachting show.
Yachty yachty.
My wife is.
Oh, my wife.
She watches these shows, unfortunately. And then when I go home on the weekends, I'm subjected to them on a loop. And it's kind of one of those things where you can't help but start to be like, well, wait, now I thought this one was with that guy last time, and now she's with him. What happened there?
It's reality.
And now all of a sudden I'm asking questions because I'm stupidly interested in it. And, you know, my mother, God bless her, had the foresight to, when I was a kid and I'd walk in to the living room and she had all my children on the TV, and I started
not Days of Our Lives?
No. Yes, that was a point of contention in our house for a long time. And I walked by and I'd be like, wait a second, I thought that person was with that person, and now, and she'd be like, get out of that, get out. You are not allowed to watch this. And I was like, oh, it's a soap opera, it's daytime. But now I know why, because it would have sucked me right in. And these shows now do that, and that was one that she got me hooked on. I don't watch it anymore, but that was...
Sure.
It was bad for a while. Actual television shows that I watch. Seen all the Game of Thrones. Seen all of Peaky Blinders. All of Taboo. All of, yeah, I love love Tom, anything Tom Hardy. Ozark. Series, yeah, that's a ton of series. So those are a few. I mean, to be honest, and those are, you know, obviously Netflix does it differently than we do, or they get it all in one time, and so I'm able to just like knock those out in a few flights, and then I'm without TV, and I have to subject it to below deck.
I feel like I'm trying to think of what's on. I watch like Tosh.0 and John Oliver, The Prophet.
That's not a TV show. She Talk said a television series or a reality show.
She said either a real show.
Just say The Bachelorette.
I've never seen
not The Bachelor with all the pretty girls. He watches The Bachelorette with all the pretty dudes.
Why do you think I took this job next to you?
That's right.
Only one pretty dude in my world.
And he's in the mirror.
I don't feel like I watched a whole lot of scriptedness. I mean, they're all scripted. Jeopardy's not scripted, I suppose.
So being a fan of both of yours from projects prior to Supernatural, not that we want Supernatural to ever end, but if you were going to go back to a prior project, what would it be, and what have you learned during your years in Supernatural that you would take back to that project with you?
Yeah, I think that was pretty easy for me. That'd be Dark Angel. And what I learned is, I would say, how to create an environment that is healthy and fun and exciting to work in, as opposed to kind of the not so great days we had on that show, which was nobody specifically's fault. It was just, there was a lot of pressure on that show, and it was unfortunate the way it ended, but I thought it had a lot of good stuff and a lot of good qualities, and I would have liked to have seen it gone on a lot longer.
Yeah. I would redo House of Wax, because it was my first time really dealing with, I'd come from Gilmore Girls, whatever I'd done, I had always been acting to a human being. House of Wax is my first real experience where it's like, okay, we need you to look at that piece of tape because this is where the bad guy comes out. I was like, what? Like, I can't see anybody, but it was such a different, I hadn't yet been used to acting to a blank wall, just for the sake of special effects and visual effects. All my stuff prior had been scenes like I did in school, like I did in drama class or plays or whatever growing up. So I feel like House of Wax kind of caught me off guard. And kind of intimidated me, so knowing what I know now, I can go back and I know how to play.
I wonder if they have like actual drama schools. Some of you might actually be able to answer this, but like in, you know, these really fancy drama schools, if they actually have courses that deal with green screen acting or acting to an imaginary universe or imaginary
or someone
people.
On camera just reading the dialogue and the other person can't see.
It's totally bizarre, and it's something that you really have to kind of get used to and understand and learn. I don't think I've ever heard of anybody teaching that or that being in the curriculum. Is what's that?
Started.
Started. Yeah, started. It's the Supernatural School of Acting to Nothing. And I don't need him.
The green tape is the vampire, the blue tape is the demon, the red tape is the okay, fight. Thank you for your question.
Everybody, it's a last question.
Eleanor from Tacoma. So we are going to do the routine of bringing you up here in front of everybody so you can see your family. And what is your question?
So when Sam and Dean salt and burn a body, I've noticed that they don't wait until the fire is out and they just leave.
Whoa. You have a different question, Eleanor?
And I was wondering if you guys waited until the fire was out and then you put the dirt back in the grave, would that give the cops one less reason to come after you and then not arrest
them? You see, I think we're leaving, my opinion is, we're leaving clues where we know we're not going to be anymore. We're not staying in the town, so we want to make sure that the local law enforcement is following us.
Let's be honest.
We don't know.
We set it up, we take safety precautions, we put fire retardant all around the grass, the surrounding areas. We've actually created a sinkhole so that when it collapses to a certain level, it actually sinks inside. We go to the diner, have a burger and a little piece of pie, we come back, finish the job, and here's the problem, it's only a 42-minute show and we can't show all that.
It's like setting up a burial, like, right? Going and eating pancakes, like, all right, time to plant the song. Going back, roll credits.
You'll also notice that our graves are dug with laser precision. They're perfect rectangles.
We've gotten really good at it.
I don't know if you've ever tried to dig a hole 6 feet into the ground. It's not pretty. Ours is.
Sign off and send these boys off stage, but we're not doing that just yet. Because we are auctioning off your sweatshirt for charity.
For those of you who have become friends and familiar with our I Am Alive friends, who where are they? We are auctioning this off to go towards all of the great work they do. It occurred to us that this is a cool sweatshirt that has never been sold, and I think with all the views that it got with our little dancing video, it was like, cool, let's raise some money for the cause. So if somebody wants it, I think it stinks because I've been wearing it all day.
Yeah, I will warn you that it's going to be soaked in the musk. You can pretty much assume. Lace in the musk. I can also assume that it'll be signed by Jared Jensen as well. So, no, sorry, just say it won't be signed. I stand corrected. It'll just be soaked in their oil. Anyway, here we go. Benedict, I turn over the auctioning to you, sir.
Again, 100%, every dollar, every cent is
every dollar.
I'm alive.
Except for, of course, the taste we got to give Rob Benedict for doing this job.
It's a large for those who are curious.
Oh, credit cards, cash, or Bolivian Coke. Thank you. No chance. Credit cards or cash. Probably the best. You're already.
All right, we're gonna start with $100.
$100.
Okay, right here, $100. Do I have 300? I have 300. I have 500 here. 500. Do I have 6? Do I have 600? 600 here. 600. 600. I have 7. 700 here. 7. Do I have 8? I have 10.
Just keep in mind,
it also smells like Jensen.
$1,000.
Listen, hold on. I'm stopping right now. Matt Cohen's unitard. His moose knuckle unitard went for $2,500. We're starting at $2,500. We're going to go ahead and go here. Let's go.
Oh, wait. We're starting.
Come on, Robbie. Make it happen.
Oh, we're starting at $2,500. Guys, see? $2,500.
We got right there. $2,500.
Where? $2,500. We got $2,500. Do I see 26? Do I see 2,600?
$2,600 here. 26 or 26, 27. $2,700 for this. Oh, look at that. $2,800. $3,000. Sorry, I lost count.
$3,000. Do I hear a dollar? Do I hear a dollar?
Okay, Rob Benedict will pay you $1,000.
Hold on. $3,000.
We have $3,000 here, right? It's that time of the afternoon where I simply say this. Good people, Seattle, Bellevue, and the surrounding counties, a big, warm thank you. It's a jam-packed.